Recorded Books and RB Digital present Heart of the City by Robert Rotenberg, narrated by David Colacci. For my longtime law partner and great friend, Alvin Shidlowski, who has always had my back. Toronto will be a fine town when it is finished. Brendan Behan. December. Ari Greene handed two passports to the customs officer and smiled at her. The passport on top was Canadian. It was his. The one underneath was British. It belonged to the young woman standing next to him.
"Where are you folks flying in from?" the officer asked, smiling back.
"London," Greene said.
"Ari Greene,"
the officer said, opening his passport. He could tell from her tone of voice that she recognized his name. He wasn't surprised. A year earlier, his name had been headline news, a top Toronto homicide detective charged with first-degree murder. And 9 months later, he'd made front-page news again when the case against him was thrown out. He watched her run his passport through the scanner on her little desk. She squinted at the screen above it. There'd be a special notation about him on file. She nodded, confirming something to herself.
"Welcome home, detective."
She flipped through the pages of his passport.
"You've been out of Canada for quite a while."
9 months, 3 weeks, and 2 days. But who's counting?" She chuckled.
"Not me."
She reached for the second passport. Her forehead crinkled when she saw it had a British cover.
"Your name is Alison Gilroy," she said, turning to the young woman at Green's side. "It is," Alison said in her English accent.
The officer examined the passport page by page. Most were empty.
"You've never been to Canada before?"
"Not for 1 minute until today."
The officer turned to Greene.
"Sir, I know you're a homicide detective, and I appreciate that this might be police business. But you realize I'm required to ask every foreign visitor what the purpose is of their visit to Canada."
Greene nodded. "Go right ahead."
"Alison, what's the purpose of your visit to Canada?"
"Actually, I'm not a visitor."
"You're not?"
"No."
The officer looked at Greene. He shrugged. She turned back to Alison.
"Are you coming here on police business?"
Alison gave her a long, slow headshake.
"Absolutely not."
The officer put Allison's passport squarely on top of Green's and tapped it with her forefinger.
"What are you going to be doing in Canada?"
"It appears I'm coming here to live."
"To live? Then why are you traveling with Detective Greene?"
Allison closed her left hand and stuck out her thumb in a hitchhiker's pose.
"Well, it turns out,"
she said, jerking her wrist toward Greene without looking at him,
"that Mr. Greene is my father."
June. Friday afternoon. Chapter 1. Every part of Greene's body hurt. His feet ached from the weight of the steel-toed boots he'd worn all week. His legs were sore from countless climbs up and down the newly poured concrete stairs of the condominium construction site. His arm muscles burned from the weight of the metal rebar he'd been hauling around since 6:30 this morning. And he had a blistering headache. He'd worked all day in the hot sun, and during the afternoon coffee break, he'd smoked a cigarette with one of his fellow workers. It was the third time since high school that he'd lit up.
"Okay, ladies, weekend's here, it's closing time,"
Claudio Basante, the site superintendent, said as he wove his way through the clusters of workers. He was one of those people whose face falls into a natural smile. 37 men in all played their parts in a well-orchestrated ballet. the formers who poured the concrete floors and walls, the carpenters who created the wooden forms the concrete was poured into, the iron workers who handled the rebar that reinforced the concrete, the electricians and plumbers who hopscotched around everyone else, securing the wiring and plumbing in place before the concrete was poured to seal everything in place, and the laborers, such as Green, who scrambled through the two basement floors and the three stories that had already been built, carrying an endless array of building materials. Above all this activity, a crane towered in constant motion, swinging back and forth like a one-armed orchestra conductor, delivering all manner of supplies to the worker bees below. In seconds, the repetitive din of metal and concrete colliding, hammers banging, and circular saws whirling all ceased. It was as if the mute button had been pushed on a loud surround sound television, replacing the noise with silence. Hard hats were removed, tools were put away, and the bright orange safety vests everyone wore were ripped off and discarded. This was the end of Green's first week on the job, and despite all his aches and pains, he had enjoyed the simple pleasure of stacking 2x4s, carrying cans of nails, hoisting the rebar onto his shoulder, trudging up and down the stairs, and laying them out in perfect order. The feel of his body straining and strengthening day by day, using muscles instead of his brain.
"Before you disappear for the weekend, we've got to get everything spick and span," Basante said to the crew. "Boy Wonder will be here any minute. He's coming to kick the tires like he does every Friday afternoon, and I want this place to look as if the Queen of England slept here last night."
Boy Wonder was Livingston Fox, a.k.a. Mr. Condo, or Mr. Con-do, depending on your point of view, the owner, CEO, and face of Fox Developments, Inc. Love him or hate him, Fox was always in the news. A high school dropout, he'd rocketed to wealth and prominence by building well-designed condominium towers throughout the city core. He threw up buildings at breakneck speed, lived an over-the-top lifestyle, complete with a chauffeur-driven Rolls-Royce convertible, and in just 10 years had played a key role in transforming the cityscape. He was 34 years old. Green had learned this first week that most of the workmen lived in suburbs and towns at least an hour's drive from Toronto. At 3:30, at the end of the workday, they were in a hurry to hit the road and avoid getting caught in rush-hour traffic. All hands pitched in, and in less than 20 minutes they were on their way. Basante had asked Green to stick around after everyone left. They hadn't had time to talk all week. It was no problem for Green. Unlike his commuting co-workers, he lived downtown and walked to work. Soon only the two of them were left. They had met in high school, a multicultural mosaic of whites, blacks, Asians, Italians, Russians, Portuguese, Protestants, Catholics, Muslims, and Jews. In many ways, it had been a precursor of everything that modern-day Toronto had become. When Basante was in grade 10, his father, an electrician, was killed while working on a hydro project down in Niagara Falls. His mother fell into a disabling depression, and Basante, the youngest child and the only one left at home, ended up practically living at Green's house for the next 3 years of school. Green sat on the edge of the third floor facing south over Kensington Market, the hodgepodge of streets and stores and houses that had been the landing spot for new immigrants for more than a century. The first heat wave of summer had rolled in overnight, bringing with it stifling humidity, and it felt good to sit up here and take in the breeze. It was one of those Toronto blue-sky afternoons, when the sun was high and would be for many more hours. Local residents, led by the high-profile lawyer Cassandra Amberlight, had formed the Save Kensington Coalition. They objected to this condominium being erected on the northern border of their neighborhood, but they'd been powerless to stop the project. Instead, they'd extracted concessions from the hated Mr. Condo and forced him to reduce his plan from 11 stories to 7. Fox, never one to be modest, named the building Kensington Gate and plastered photos of himself alongside happy-looking, athletic young people across the hoardings that flanked the site. Last November, Fox had announced plans for a second condominium high-rise down the street. He'd cheekily named it Kensington Gate 2, or as he liked to call it, K2, and was promoting it as the peak of luxury in every way. Some people thought he was doing this just to rub salt in Amberlite's wounds. The venom between the builder and the protest leader was public and palpable. She'd come up with the term Mr. Condo. He called her Ms. Red Light because she opposed every development he proposed. Amberlite had spent the last few weeks organizing a march that was going to take place in the market this afternoon to oppose what she called density creep. From his perch on the third floor, Green could see television trucks already lined up along Augusta Avenue, the street next to the building, where groups of protesters were gathering. Most were young people with a smattering of scruffy-looking veterans. A few of them had brought their dogs. Others had babies in carriers. Many held aloft signs that read, "Stop the Fox, Save the Market." Others had their phones on telescopic selfie sticks and were filming themselves and the cops standing by. One man was pounding away on a big African drum, whipping up the crowd. Green heard boots on the concrete behind him and turned to see Basante walking over, carrying two Corona beers.
"You'll have to drink it without any lime," he said, sitting down and passing Green one of the bottles.
"I think I can handle it," Green laughed and took a sip.
"You've worked 5 days straight, Ari. How do you feel?"
"A little sore."
Basante waved his bottle in the air.
"You were always a lousy liar," he said, "even back in grade 9.
"Okay."
Green took a longer sip. The beer was sweet and cool.
"I hurt like hell all over."
"That's why God created the weekend. Rest up, stay cool. Take your daughter to a movie where there's air conditioning or something."
Below them, on Augusta Avenue, more and more protesters were crowding onto the narrow street, singing and dancing and chanting. Green looked at Basante.
"Why aren't you drinking your beer?"
"Boy Wonder will be here at 4. Guy's never late. I have to play the corporate game."
He flicked the bottom of his bottle out toward the commotion on the street.
"Look at those kids there. What do they think? They have some special right to live down here and hang out in their trendy coffee shops all day while Mommy and Daddy pay the rent? My guys, with wives and kids to support, they're stuck out in the burbs and commuting 2 or 3 hours a day. I'd like to see just one of these protesters put in a real day's work."
He took one small sip of his beer, put the bottle by his side, pulled out a roll of Mentos mints, and popped a few in his mouth. He stretched his arms over his head.
"Ari, look at this city," he said, pointing south. "Remember when we were kids? There wasn't one high-rise downtown. Now it's all condos and office towers. Condos, condos, and more condos. See those two new big ones down by the CN Tower?
They all look new.
The one on the left, I moved in there last year. You'll have to come down and see it. View of the lake is amazing."
"And the view of the building cranes," Green said. "They're everywhere."
"Toronto, it's a city of cranes. Cost us a fortune."
Basante pointed to the streets below.
"Every time we put up a new building, there's some lawyer acting for a neighbor I have to negotiate with and pay off. Then all we do is raise their property values. Good work if you can get it. You see that house on the other side of the alley?"
Green followed his gaze. The house was an unremarkable two-story brick building with a second-floor window at the back covered by a heavy brown curtain. An alleyway ran between it and the building site, then turned south behind the homes facing west on Augusta Avenue and the restaurants and stores facing east on Spadina Avenue.
What about it? Green asked.
Because our crane casts a shadow when it passes over the house, we had to negotiate a crane swing agreement with the owners to pay for their inconvenience. This one cost us $30,000. Some numbered company owns it, and the place is empty anyhow. Can you believe that? Happens every time we put up a building.
Basante stood, and as he rose, his leg nudged his beer bottle. It tumbled over the edge of the building and smashed onto the extended balcony of the floor below.
Christ,
Basante said, chewing hard on a few more mints.
I'll take care of it, Green said. You go meet young Mr. Condo.
Thanks, pal. The broom and dustpan are in the workshed near the back gate.
Basante pulled out his phone.
Weird. He should be here by now. He usually calls as soon as he arrives. Maybe he's spending some private time with that gorgeous chauffeur of his.
Green finished his beer and put the bottle in his pants pocket. He took his time descending the stairs. Walking down was harder on his sore legs than walking up. The shed was past a pair of Johnny-on-the-spot portable toilets at the back corner of the site. Green hadn't been inside it since his first day at work, when he'd been outfitted with a hard hat and safety gear. He was sweating in the heat, and the air as he walked past the toilets reeked. When he got to the shed, it occurred to him how cut off it was from the rest of the worksite. He pulled open the spring-loaded door. The heat hit him first. It was furnace hot inside. The sun streamed through a large south-facing window and blinded him for a moment. But all his years as a street cop and homicide detective had honed his instincts. Something about the stillness of the room wasn't right. He could feel before he could see that there was someone else in the room. As his eyes adjusted, he could see through the window the hoarding that surrounded the building site, and above it the old house on the other side of the alley. Then he looked down. Livingston Fox was lying flat on his back, right in the middle of the floor. He wasn't wearing one of his usual hand-tailored Italian suits, just a plain white cotton T-shirt and a pair of khaki shorts. His arms and his legs lay limply beside him, his hands and feet anchored by heavy concrete blocks. His head was slouched to one side. His eyes bulged open, unmoving. And his chest was pierced by a long steel rebar plunged right through his heart.
Chapter 2. It was Friday afternoon, and Homicide Detective Daniel Kennicott was glad the week was finally over. Even better, the murder trial he'd worked on for the last 3 months was finished, and the courthouse had emptied out, so he could be alone now in the Crown Attorney's office storage room. He stared at the evidence boxes stacked in three towers stretching up to the ceiling, and at the piles of papers and folders scattered on the large desk in the corner. No matter how long it took, he was going to file every scrap of it away tonight. He wanted to be done with the case of Wainwright Campbell, the punk who'd killed Kyle Little, a hard-working young man who'd stood up to Campbell's gang activity and had been shot in the back of his head for his troubles. The case had concluded yesterday, and the jury was out for the night. Half an hour ago, they'd come back with their verdict. Campbell was guilty of first-degree murder. To Kennicott, it felt good. Very, very good. Behind him, the door swung open. Albert Fernandez, the prosecutor, came in still wearing his crisply pressed court robes. Unlike some lawyers who grew progressively shabbier as a long trial dragged on, Fernandez was always well-dressed. He wore a fresh white shirt every day, shined his black shoes to a high gloss, and no matter how tired he was, never let it show. He put a banker's box squarely on the corner of the crowded desk.
"This is the last one," he said. "It contains all my trial notes."
Fernandez was also one of the most organized people Kennicott had ever met. The contents of this box would be labeled and in perfect order.
"I must get home. My wife and kids have hardly seen me for months," Fernandez said. "I'll come in Sunday morning to help you pack everything up correctly."
"No problem," Kennicott said. "I've got this."
"Thanks. Very kind of you."
They looked at each other. For the last 10 weeks, the two men had lived in the cocoon of this case, working around the clock. There had been no media coverage of the trial, and no one in the Crown's office had paid any attention to it. That didn't matter to either of them. They had worked as hard on this trial as they would have done had it made the headlines. The only spectators regularly in court had been Kyle Little's bereaved mother and aunt. And now, what did those two women have left? The emptiness of their lives without their son and nephew. But at least the killer had been convicted.
"You should be proud of the work you did," Fernandez said.
"You should be, too."
They shook hands.
"Don't stay late."
"No worries."
Kennicott shut the door behind Fernandez. Back at the desk, he picked up a binder and filed it in a new empty box. There would almost certainly be an appeal, and he wasn't going to leave any stone unturned to make sure this verdict stuck. Ari Greene, the detective who had brought Kennicott into the homicide squad and been his mentor, had taught him that it was best to pack up a file right away. You never knew what was going to happen next, and if you put the task off, you never knew when you'd get back to it.
Kennicott shook his head.
"Ari Greene."
He kept trying to put the man out of his mind. For 5 years, Greene had kept him under his wing, had shown him secret parts of the city where he had contacts and hiding places. They'd often meet early in the morning at Caldense, a Portuguese bakery on Dundas Street West, about a 10-minute walk from Kennicott's flat. Greene would question him about a case they were investigating. He'd been like a law professor, prodding Kennicott to think through things from a different angle. 2 years ago, everything changed when Jennifer Raglan, the former head Crown attorney, was found strangled to death in a room at a sleazy motel. Kennicott had been the officer in charge of the case. It came to light that Greene had been her lover. He'd found her body but had run from the scene without calling 911 and had tried to hide their affair. Kennicott had been forced to charge the man who had been his mentor, then his partner, with first-degree murder. 6 months later, the case collapsed when Greene figured out who the real killer was. Hap Charlton, the former chief of police who had been elected mayor of Toronto. Kennicott was left feeling a crosswind of emotions. He was angry with Greene for not being honest with him, and furious at himself for arresting an innocent man. Greene left the country the day after his charges were thrown out. He'd disappeared without saying goodbye. Rumor was that he'd gone somewhere in Europe, but nobody knew exactly where he was or if he was ever coming back. It would probably be best for everyone, Kennicott thought, if he stayed away. The ceiling fan in the storage room clicked on, making a pleasant white noise. He could have propped the door open to let fresh air inside, but he didn't. He was in no hurry. He wasn't dying to go back to his apartment alone. The weather was hot and the city was in bloom. It would be a beautiful night outside. Wonderful for normal people who led normal lives. But it meant nothing to Kennicott. So much for the romance of being a homicide detective. His phone rang with the hotshot ringtone indicating an urgent call. That meant there had been another murder in the city. The detectives who had families had all booked off time for their vacations, so the homicide squad was short-staffed. Now that his trial was over, Kennicott was on the bubble. He didn't move. Every ounce of his being wanted to ignore his phone. He looked at the photos that he'd taken from the file. There was a picture of Kyle, a warm smile on his face, coming home from work in his Walmart uniform. Another of him playing soccer with the kids in the scrubby courtyard of the housing complex where he'd lived with his mother and aunt. And one of them with his family and friends, blowing out candles on his birthday cake last spring when he turned 25. The phone hit its third ring. Two more and it would go to voicemail. Kennicott had learned that to be a great homicide detective, you had to do more than just walk in the victim's shoes. You had to care for the victim with every ounce of your being. It was as if you were falling in love with someone you would never get to meet. The phone rang for the fifth and final time. He stabbed the answer button. "Kennicott," he said, making sure he hid the fatigue in his voice. "What have we got?" Chapter 3 Green stood in the doorway and stared at Fox's body. Tongue hanging out, eyes glazed, limb slack. The rebar sticking out of his chest and the heavy cement blocks pinning him to the floor like a dead butterfly on a scientist's presentation board. A thin rivulet of blood had slithered down his body and pooled on the floor beside him. Green didn't move. This was a crime scene. But even from this distance he could see the blood had not yet congealed. In the oven-like heat of the room, blood would dry fast. This murder had happened a very short time ago. He felt sick. He was sweating and his mind was whirling back to that horrible morning when he'd found Jennifer strangled to death in a motel room. It had been the worst moment of his life. He'd been so excited that day, rushing to meet her for what was going to be their final covert rendezvous. Final because at last Jennifer had decided to leave her husband. There would be no more secrets, no more hiding. Finally they could be together. But Jennifer was gone. Gone. Sure, he had been arrested, put on trial, the case thrown out. But what did it really matter? Without Jennifer, did anything really matter? Thank goodness he'd found his daughter, Alison. She and his dad were the only people he cared about now. He wanted to make a new life with her. What he didn't want was to be a cop anymore, to have to stare at dead bodies. And yet here he was, his eyes fixed on Livingston Fox, dead, horribly murdered. He knew he should run, move, but his feet wouldn't budge. He lifted his eyes from the body and scanned the room. The shed was small. There was no other door. The afternoon sunlight streamed in through the large south-facing window. Two bare bulbs shone overhead. Neatly stacked papers on a makeshift desk were surrounded by a white jar filled with pens, a black jar filled with pencils, a stapler, a three-hole punch, two empty water bottles, one blue and one orange, and a pair of empty drinking glasses. Everything was neatly in place. Green looked at the walls and the plywood floor. There were no obvious signs of blood spatter anywhere. A stray pencil lay under the desk. He took in every detail, memorized it. He turned away and dug into his pocket for his phone. The biggest blunder he'd made when he found Jennifer's body in that horrid motel room had been not calling 911 right away. He wasn't going to make that mistake again. He tapped in the number.
"What is your emergency?"
a calm female voice asked.
"A man has been murdered. I just came upon his body."
He knew the operator had a standard set of questions and he wanted to cut through them quickly.
"The address is Kensington Gate Condominium on College Street, west of Spadina, the south side. The place is under construction. I'm in the shed at the back."
"I've dispatched police and an ambulance," the operator said after a moment's silence. "I need a few more details. Who are you, sir?"
Green paused. Who was he? Homicide Detective Ari Greene? Former Homicide Detective Ari Greene, construction worker Ari Greene, Allison's father Ari Greene.
I work here. Construction, he said.
Do you know the victim?
Green hesitated again. If he said Fox's name, there was a chance a media scanner would pick it up. If he said he didn't know, that would be a lie.
Sir, you still there?
The dead man is Livingston Fox, he said, the owner of the property.
He hung up before she could ask more questions. The shed door was on a spring. He opened it with his elbow and let it shut on his own. He should tell Claudio right away what was going on before the cops arrived. Instead, he stopped. The blood beside the body was fresh. The shed had one door. Where had the killer gone? Green checked the ground outside the shed. No blood. How had the killer got onto the site? The only entrance, other than the main gate on College Street, was the gate in the chain-link fence behind the shed leading to the alleyway. It was steps away. He shouldn't. He knew he shouldn't. This was the worst time in his life to get involved in a murder investigation. He was determined to keep out of the limelight, and Livingston Fox's murder would be headline news. He had to focus on his daughter. After 6 tough months, Alison finally seemed to be settling into life in Toronto. But the killer might be close. Every second counted. The chanting and drumming of the protesters on Augusta Avenue was growing louder. It would be easy for the killer to disappear into the crowd. The cops wouldn't arrive for a few more minutes, and by then it would be too late. He walked quickly around the shed. Never run. He could trip, and that would be a disaster. He had to stay calm, focused. The back gate was ajar. The combination lock was open, hanging from the handle. Whoever had entered either knew the combination or Fox had opened the gate for them. Green stopped to listen. No sirens yet. He had 30 seconds, maybe fewer. The gate was open wide enough for him to slip through without touching it. He half-tiptoed through in his construction boots, searching the ground at his feet. Dry concrete. No footprints. Not a sign of blood anywhere. One step outside, he stopped and looked around. Across from him was the old two-story house at Augusta Avenue, and he could see the protesters and the TV trucks out on the street at the western end of the alley. Just outside the gate, there was a puddle in the shade against the fence, where one of the protesters' big dogs must have peed. He wanted to walk over to where the alley turned south. Did he have time? He stopped to listen and couldn't hear a police siren yet. He moved fast and peered around the corner. The back alley was like hundreds he'd seen in downtown Toronto. On the west side, there were the back of the stores and restaurants on Spadina. The east side was lined with wooden garages belonging to the houses on Augusta, their metal doors slathered with colorful graffiti. A rusty ball hockey net and a clutch of hockey sticks were propped against one door, and 2 bikes were locked to a wooden fence by a heavy chain. In back of one of the restaurants, cigarette butts were piled on the pavement beside a pair of overturned red milk crates. He returned to the open gate for one last look, turned to the 2-story house across the alley. There had to be a clue. Something. Nothing. Chapter 4. Alison Gilroy had lost track. How many little cups of green tea had she drunk in the last half hour? 8? Maybe 10? She was sitting alone in the back room of Wee Bing Gardens, a steamy Chinese restaurant on Spadina Avenue, staring at her empty notebook, thinking it made no sense. Livingston Fox, the so-called king of condos, was supposed to have met her here at 3. She checked her phone for the time. It was 3:15 and Fox still hadn't shown up for their meeting. This was not like him.
His life was scheduled into exact time slots. For the last month, she'd met him here at the same time every Friday afternoon for a half-hour meeting, and he'd always been on time. Fox had been a terrific source of stories for Kensington Confidential, the blog she'd started 2 months earlier. Last week, he'd told her he had an even better story for her. He said it was going to make major headlines and send her blog's numbers through the roof. The man was obsessed with secrecy. Before their first meeting at the restaurant, he'd given her precise directions about how to get here, which she'd followed to a T. Every Friday afternoon, she walked along Oxford, one block south of college, then up a path to the alleyway at the back of the restaurant, where a red milk crate held the rear door open. Inside, behind a beaded curtain, was this room with two chairs and a table always set with a pot of tea and a pair of little white porcelain cups. Fox had insisted that she never go into the main restaurant and had told her that none of the staff would ever come into the room. She was to wait alone until he showed up. So where was he? Why hadn't he come? This morning she'd awoken to her first taste of Canadian-style summer heat and humidity. Back home in England, they didn't have anything like this. To make matters worse, this room had no windows and no air conditioning. She had never been so hot. It all felt like more bad luck in the worst year of her life. One night last August, 2 weeks before she was set to start her second year at university, her mother collapsed while cooking dinner. Alison had called emergency right away, but it hadn't made any difference. Her mother had died before she hit the ground. A brain aneurysm, the doctor said. Could happen to anyone at any time. Alison was an only child, and her mother was the only family she had. She'd never met her father. Her mother had told her he'd left when she was a baby and was living somewhere in New Zealand with a new wife and kids. That's what Alison believed until a week after her mother died, when David Joyce, the family solicitor, invited her to his office to discuss her mom's will. "Alison, I have a rather large surprise for you," Joyce said when she walked in. The man she had never seen before was sitting in a chair across from the lawyer's desk. "This is Detective Ari Greene. He's Canadian." Greene stood. He was tall and had a nice smile. Alison had no idea what he was doing there.
"Detective," she said with a nervous laugh, "is there something wrong?"
"No, not at all," Greene said.
He had a quiet warmth, and there was something vaguely familiar about him. What was it?
"I'm from Toronto. I knew your mother years ago when she lived in Canada."
"I remember. Mum told me she liked the snow, and she said that the summers were beautiful but terribly humid."
She looked at Joyce.
"I don't understand."
Joyce glanced down at some papers on his desk.
"Your mother had planned to tell you about Mr. Greene when you turned 21. She left me specific instructions that if, in the unfortunate event that something happened to her before that time, I should contact both you and Mr. Greene."
She looked back at the stranger.
"Sir, can you explain this?"
"After your mother returned to England, she sent me a Christmas card every year with a picture of the two of you," Greene said.
"Those photos were so embarrassing. I hope you threw them out."
"No, I kept them all."
"Why would you do that?"
He gave her a blank look.
"Wait. What year did Mum leave Canada?"
1995.
Her birthday was on February 1st, 1996.
"When? What month?"
"April."
It wasn't hard to do the math, but it didn't make any sense. She turned to Joyce.
"But Mum told me my father lives in New Zealand, and..."
The lawyer shook his head.
"I'm afraid she made that up."
Alison nodded. She started to rock from side to side. This was unbelievable. She looked at Green, stared. It took a few seconds until he returned her gaze. Yes, something about him was familiar. It was his eyes. He had the same gray-green eyes with flecks of yellow as she had.
"Did you know?" she demanded.
"I didn't. I had no idea."
"But you kept our Christmas cards?"
"I don't know why. I just did."
How could this be? In the last week, she'd lost her mother and found a father. "Do you have a family or something?"
she asked him.
"No, I've never been married. Never had children. Well, never thought I did until..."
His voice drifted off. "Your mother thought it was easier this way," Joyce said.
"Like you, Detective Green was gobsmacked when I informed him. I assure you she was going to tell both of you."
"Toronto?"
Now Alison was shaking her head.
"Yes, Toronto."
"You mean I'm half Canadian?"
"I guess you are."
He laughed for the first time. So did she.
"Well,"
she said, taking a few steps toward him,
"I suppose we should shake hands or something."
It felt strange, but at the same time comforting to touch him. He told her he was staying in a hotel near Russell Square and that he was in no hurry to leave. He wanted time to get to know her. She liked the idea. She Googled his name right after that first meeting. He was a top homicide detective and the only child of Holocaust survivors. The weird thing was, she loved P.D. James's mysteries, which featured an older detective who was single with no kids. Google turned up tons of articles about Jennifer Raglan, a Crown prosecutor who'd been murdered. Raglan, a married woman, had been Green's lover. He'd been charged with murdering her, and while he was out on bail, he'd found the real killer. Amazing. At first, their relationship was strained. She was a journalism student, and a few times a week he'd take her out to dinner after school. He was shy and awkward around her. She didn't know him well enough to hug or kiss him, but she liked his sly sense of humor, and she'd give him a playful punch on his arm whenever she cracked a joke or he said something funny. He rented a flat near her home, and bit by bit he became the one steady person in her life while everything else was falling apart. Every place she went in London reminded her of her mother. She hated sitting in class, and her mind kept wandering. Her friends' crises and concerns seemed trivial. "You broke up with your boyfriend? Well, guess what? My mother just fell down dead, and this stranger from Canada showed up, and he's my father." She called him Ari. There was no way she was going to call him Dad, and she wasn't going to call him Mr. Green, so she settled on his first name. After he'd been in England for about 3 months, she announced over dessert in a vegetarian restaurant in Soho,
"I'm going to quit school."
She thought he wouldn't like the idea, and he'd tell her that she should try to stick it out. But he understood right away.
"You can't concentrate, can you?" he said.
"How'd you guess?"
"Remember, I was a homicide detective for a long time. I've seen how hard it is for people to recover from the death of a loved one, especially a parent."
"I think I need to get out of London."
"Makes sense. Where do you want to go?"
"Well,"
she said, nervous around him for the first time and unsure how he would react to her idea.
"How about I move to Canada with you?"
He almost choked on the rhubarb pie he was eating, before he broke out in a gigantic grin. A month later, they were on a plane. In Toronto, she met his father, her grandfather Yitzhak, who was the opposite of Ari. Outgoing and fun, he hugged and kissed her all the time.
Within days she was calling him Grandpa Y, and soon he started fixing up a room for her in the basement of Ari's house to give her some privacy. He took her to Kensington Market, where he'd lived when he first came to Canada. Kensington wasn't exactly Portobello, but it wasn't all modern and ordered like most parts of Toronto. It was the first place in the city where she felt at home. Because Ari was Canadian, she had the automatic right to citizenship, but since he wasn't listed on her birth certificate, she was required to get a DNA test for proof. Ari, being a homicide detective, had already had one done.
"It turns out I'm three-quarters Jewish," she told him and Grandpa Y when the results arrived. "There was always a bit of mystery about where Grammy, my mum's mum, came from."
"Do you think your mother knew?" Ari asked.
"I'll never know," she said.
"But now we know," Grandpa Y said. "Where you got your sense of humor?"
They all laughed. It was a warm moment. She checked the time again on her phone. It was 3:45. She'd been waiting for Fox for three-quarters of an hour, and now the big story, the protest march, was about to start one block away. She was tempted to call Fox's assistant, Maxine, but he'd made her promise that no matter what, even if he were late, she wouldn't ask anyone where he was. He wasn't late. He wasn't coming. She had to leave. But it was complicated. In January, at Ari's suggestion, so she could meet people her age, get to know the city, and further her career, Alison had enrolled in journalism school downtown for the winter and summer term. But just like when she'd gone back to school in London after her mother died, she couldn't focus. She started skipping classes and hanging out in Kensington Market. She launched Kensington Confidential as an anonymous blog and wrote about the community and its growing conflicts with developers. People began to send her stories, and within weeks she had more than 2,000 followers. Now 30 others wrote alongside her, including the activist Cassandra Amberlight, who posted 5 or 6 times a day. Managing the blog was taking up all her time, and a month ago she'd dropped out of school. The problem was that she didn't have the heart to tell Ari what she was doing. He'd been supportive of her going back to school. Recently, she'd been getting inquiries about buying ad space on her blog, and she wanted to wait until it was bringing in good money to break the news to him. In the meantime, she pretended she was still a student, and they'd text each other at 4 every afternoon when she'd supposedly finished her classes. But then, last week, Ari got a job at the Kensington Gate construction site. Talk about bad timing. She had to cover the demonstration, but she couldn't risk his seeing her on the street or on TV. Before coming into the restaurant, she'd gone to one of the second-hand shops in the market and bought a plain black T-shirt, a pair of white shorts, cheap sunglasses, and a Toronto Blue Jays cap and a small yellow backpack, and had changed into the new clothes. As long as she wore the baseball cap, Ari wouldn't be able to spot her in the crowd. She checked the time again. It was 3:50, and she was so hot. That was it. She threw back the last of the tea and smacked the cup down on the formica table. She put on the sunglasses and the baseball cap, slipped on the backpack, and headed out the back door. Where the hell, she wondered, was Livingston Fox? Chapter 5. Kennicott ducked out of the Crown Attorney storage room, sprinted down the crisscrossing courthouse escalators, and ran out under the street. After being indoors all day, he felt the heat and humidity hit him and immediately began to sweat. He jumped into a squad car that pulled up for him. A young female officer was at the wheel.
"Detective Kennicott," he said. "P.C. Shepherd, 3615, she said, a big grin on her face. "You might want to do up your seatbelt."
She blasted her high-volume siren and gunned the engine.
"Good idea,"
he said, buckling up as the car lurched forward and threw him back against the seat. He grabbed the door handle to steady himself while she swerved through traffic. With his free hand, he pulled out his phone. Detective Kamil Darvish, his newly assigned partner, had recently been promoted to homicide, and this would be his first major case. He would have gotten news of the murder and was probably waiting for Kennicott's call.
It's Kennicott. You heard?
I did.
Who found the body?
A worker at the site.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.